Hi, I'm Dr. Arghir-Nicolae Moldovan from National College of Ireland. I will present this project, which was based on Smriti's work. Smriti was an MSc student on our MSc in cybersecurity. Basically, the focus is on machine learning and feature selection for website phishing detection. The outline of the talk, very brief introduction, and motivation and goals, methodology, the results and conclusions, and then I will take questions and answers. If you attended an earlier presentation, it was on a similar topic on URL or website phishing detection. Some of the statistics I noticed that they were also quoted by the author of that paper. So phishing is one of the most popular attacks, and basically it focuses on social engineering, trying to pull users into giving away confidential information like passwords. There are different types of phishing attacks, email phishing. We also saw another presentation on phishing. And then there are a lot of websites that are used by malicious actors, so-called web phishing websites, and that is the topic of our research. Now, according to some recent trends on phishing, especially on website phishing, Google has registered over 2.11 million phishing websites in 2020. As per the anti-phishing working group, which provided this nice statistic, there is an increasing and growing trend in the number of detected phishing websites. Say in the beginning of January 2020, they were about less than 100,000, but in December 2020, they were around 200,000 phishing websites detected. Especially since the pandemic had started, we've seen a huge increase in phishing attacks. So the attackers are profiting of this unfortunate situation. And according to F5 Labs, they were over 220 increase in phishing attacks in 2020. Most of these attacks use the keywords related to the pandemic, like COVID, Corona, and some worrying trends are also the increasing use of TLS encryption and HTTPS. So kind of simple recommendations to users to watch the browsers and to make sure that the websites are secure that they visit. They don't really work. Now, phishing websites are increasingly realistic, and there is a need for both increased user training and awareness and automatic phishing detection solutions. Phishing detection solutions can be classified under different categories. One popular approach is the blacklist, and you've seen, for example, you have the Google same browsing that registers phishing websites, and the browser will notify you if you access any malicious website. Then there are websites such as Fish Tank and OpenFish. Now, machine learning based phishing website detection, there was a extensive work in this area, peer work, and some kind of limitations with peer work. They include the fact that some works have used a large number of features, and it may not be feasible to extract some of these features for real-time detection. Another thing that we looked at was how the performance of the algorithms would change if you combine different datasets. So while some previous works have evaluated machine learning algorithms on separate multiple datasets, they did not attempt to combine the data. Some research goals of this work include to perform feature selection for building robust, more robust machine learning-based phishing website detection models, to identify common features between different website phishing datasets, and to investigate the usefulness of variance inflation factor as a feature selection method. Now, this was being a machine learning project. We used a systematic approach that followed the KDD methodology, which consists of steps such as data selection, pre-processing, transformation, data mining, and evaluation. For the data selection, we initially looked at creating our own data sets using, taking in the previous paper that we've seen earlier in the day, by taking websites or URLs from Fishtank and our crawler, but we face some difficulties with feature extraction, and also our MSc programs are very short, so the students only have 3 months to complete their project. Then we looked at what phishing datasets are available out there, and what is the kind of the commonalities between the different datasets. And 2 datasets were selected here, one with 30 features, another one with 40 features. The first one contains both internal features. Internal features are those that are derived from web page URL, as well as HTML, JavaScript source code. And the first dataset also included external features, which were obtained from querying third-party services such as DNS search engine, quiz report. The second dataset only contained internal features. The authors of that dataset justified their selection of only internal features on kind of similar reasons, in the sense that some of the it can become more problematic to extract external features for some websites if you want to use them for real-time website phishing detection. The categories of features for the different datasets can be grouped under different categories, like URL-based for DS1, 30 URL-based, abnormal-based, HTML, JavaScript-based, or domain-based. And for the second data set, again, these ones, they did not include domain-based features. Now, for the data preparation and transformation step, the data sets were relatively clean. Yes?
A little background noise, right? Impossible to...
I cannot hear you well.
We have a lot of background noise from your side. Impossible you could put the volume or sounds like a fan or a printer.
Is it better if I don't use the earphones?
Yes, it's much better. Thank you.
Okay, so it's probably okay. So these data sets were relatively clean, and there wasn't much data preparation needed there. The second data set had one attribute with all values on 0, so we didn't really use that one, the machine learning. And then one goal of the research was to identify common features between the 2 data sets. And basically here we identified 18 common features. They use different names, but when we identified them, we did it based on the data set descriptions provided by the authors. The data transformation was focused on transforming the second data set, the DS218, the common features, to match the binary or categorical format used by the first data set. In total, when we combine the 2 data sets, we obtain the DS1, what we encoded as DS1 to 18, with 18 features, which had over 20,000 instances. 47% of them were phishing class, and 53% they were legitimate class. The second data set, the DS2, also contains some numeric features, But again, in the data transformation process, those numeric features were encoded as binary or categorical. The next step was to perform feature selection. And here, priori search typically looked at using measures such as gene index, gene ratio, for example, Pearson correlation. These were more popular methods for feature selection. Because the data was all encoded as numeric, we decided to take a different approach here and to use the various inflation factor in order to remove some of the features and to keep only the optimal features. Now, what is variance inflation factor? This is used for identifying multicollinearity. So collinearity, basically, it's the situation where you have high correlation between two features. That is typically determined using, say, Pearson or Spearman or Kendall correlation. We use Spearman correlation here. But multicollinearity is the situation when we can have collinearity between multiple features, even if you do not have high collinearity between pairs of features. How is computing? So basically you do a multiple regression model where you predict one feature based on all the other features, and then you repeat the process for all the different features, and then you do a stepwise approach in the sense that you remove one feature with the highest VIF score at each step, and then you reiterate the process, and so on and so forth. Now, the feature selection was performed by removing all the features with a VIF score of 5 and above, which indicate critical multicollinearity issues. Some other works also, basically, a score of 5 will correspond to an R square of over 80, so or 0.8. Which means that 80% of the variance of the feature that we want to predict is explained by the other features. So based on this approach, we identified 13 optimal features, and we encoded that data set as DS1 to 13. Looking just at simply the collinearity between the features, the highest correlation, Spearman correlation, was observed, for example, between pop-up window and on-mouse over at 0.73. For the data mining, we looked at what prior research have done. Some works have compared traditional machine learning with tree-based methods and ensemble methods. And based on the prior research, we selected two algorithms, random forest, which was shown to outperform a variety of other machine learning algorithms in previous studies. It tends to perform well using default settings. So this is one of the strongest benefits of random forest. And then the other one was gradient boosting machine. This was often not included in comparison by previous studies, but I noticed again that the earlier paper was, they used XGBoost. Now, we didn't use XGBoost. XGBoost is a particular implementation of gradient boosting machine. We have used the H2O implementation. So H2O, it's an open source framework. And they also, on Mac and Linux, they also integrate the XGBoost. But on Windows, they have their, on Windows, they only have their own GPM implementation. Okay. The models were built with different sets of hyperparameter values to identify optimal values. Now, with gradient boosting machine, it typically requires a more hyperparameter tuning. And again, with random forest, a big advantage is that it tends to perform well with default settings. GBMs have become quite popular these days with machine learning, and we've seen, for example, many Kaggle competitions are won by implementations based on GBMs. Now, Now, for the evaluation, the initial, the first experiment basically was to compare on these data sets, the common feature data sets, as well as the baseline data sets with all the features, as well as the optimal data set, to compare the two algorithms, random forest with GBM. And for that one, we use 80-20 split into training and test. We compute several metrics: accuracy, precision, recall, sensitivity, specificity, and AUC. More detailed results are presented in the paper. In the presentation, I'll mainly focus on accuracy. Methodology workflow. So the idea again was to combine multiple data sets to identify common features, then to split the data into 80-20 to perform feature selection. Now, the feature selection again was performed on the combined data set on the ES1 to 18. And then we took from there, we took the best performing model, which was random foresting from our experiments, and we integrated that into a Python-based application that takes as input the URL, performs feature extraction, and predicts the type of website. But that one was more for just to evaluate basically the runtime. Okay? How feature reducing the number of feature and the number of features impacts on the extraction type. When it comes to the results, the first part of the results looked at the model performance, and again, these ones compared the two algorithms, the distributed random forest with the gradient boosting machine. Now, distributed random forest, it's just random forest, but the H2O, basically they use the terminology of DRF, distributed random forest, and it's distributed in the sense that multiple trees are built in parallel. H2O, it's a distributed framework in the sense that you can run it on a cluster of nodes or on cloud computing. But because the data sets were quite small, all the experiments were just done on a local Windows laptop. And basically, we only use the two CPUs and basically the cluster consisted of one node and two CPU cores. Now, all the models, so this graph basically, and this experiment compares the results in terms of accuracy. So we only report here the accuracy and the AUC results. And we report them for the data sets, all the features, DS130, DS248, which is basically the baseline performance. We observe from the experiments that DRF tends to outperform gradient boosting machine, except in one case on DS248, where the GBM provides slightly higher accuracy. But otherwise, we notice that distributed random forest tends to provide, in terms of absolute values, slightly better accuracy, but again, the difference is quite small. So say, for example, the baseline performance for DRF, it's 97.4%. For DS248, it's 98.5%. Now, on the common features, here again, we had three data sets. We had the DS118, DS218, and DS1218. And there, the accuracy is higher, slightly higher for DS1, 0.952, which means that basically the accuracy decreased by 2.2% from the baseline. For the DS2, reducing from 48 features to 18 features, the accuracy decreased by 4.8% from the baseline. And here, the higher drop in performance can be explained by the data transformation, in the sense that while, as you can see here in this plot, the accuracy was higher. Sorry, the accuracy was higher for the full feature data set. you have to know that this 18 feature data set was transformed in the sense that we do not have the we do not have numeric features. We brought them into the same format with the DS1. On the combined data set, basically the accuracy is the same as for the DS2. It's 0.93.7% but the AUC is slightly higher. Now, after feature selection using VIF, the accuracy by removing five other features, the accuracy stayed the same. So it's 93.7% as on the 18 features data set, but the AUC again here, it decreased by 0.006. Now, a second experiment looked at how does our results compare with previous state of the art on these two data sets. Now, because we have used public data sets, we decided to do a second experiment just to compare how the choice of algorithms in the case performs with the best results reported by those authors. Now, the authors of the original papers, they use different data split or cross-validation techniques. And for this experiment, basically, we repeated the experiments by doing the same evaluation method. Okay. Now, on the first data set on DS130, if we compare the, so again, our best results were for distributed random forest. And if we compare the results with Subasi et al., they use tenfold cross-validation. So we took the same approach and they achieve slightly higher accuracy using random forest. Again, you see the same pattern. Basically, most of previous works reported best results for some form of random forest. Okay, so on the Another study by Rahman et al., they use 65% for test and 35% for sorry, 65% for training, 35% for test, and they use extreme randomized trees. And again, they achieve slightly higher accuracy there by about 0.3%. Now, looking at the second data set, DS248. Same study by Rahman et al., they also data set on 65-35 split, their ERT model achieves 0.98, while our distributed random forest achieves 0.981. And another study that used 70-30% split, they reported the best result using random forest 0.962, which was significantly lower than the change with the distributed random forest, 98.4. Okay. Now, looking at the model building time, basically the distributed random forest building time on DS1 to 13 is 40% lower than the time on DS1 30, and it's 56% lower than on the 48 feature data set. Reduction in terms of model building time, which includes both training and test, it's at least 40% compared with the 30 features and 56% with the 40 feature data set. For feature extraction time, here we use the smaller data set of live websites. And again, we build that application, but only the 30 features were extracted. So basically here in terms of feature extraction time, it's 6.5 times lower for legitimate emails and 3.5 times lower for phishing emails. We notice that there isn't really a difference between extracting 30 and 18 features. So the extraction time is comparable, but there is a significant reduction in the feature extraction time as compared to the to extracting the full 30 features. So in conclusion, basically, we perform feature selections to build a more robust machine learning model for phishing website detection. We combine two data sets here with 13, 14 features and analyze them to identify 18 matching features. The feature selection approach was variance inflation factor, which was conducted to identify 13 optimal features. And the best model there performs quite well. So again, the decrease was of 5% as compared to the baseline on the 48 feature data set. So the results, they confirm pre-research findings that random forest tends to perform very well. Random forest didn't really require a lot of feature selection, a lot of hyperparameter tuning. With GBM, we did more hyperparameter tuning, but we can conclude that probably more can be done in order to fully evaluate their performance. Okay. And again, we used it can also depends a lot on what particular GBM implementation we use. And in this particular study, we have used the GBM implementation from the H2. Other implementations include XGBoost, TadaBoost. Now, future work will focus on comparing with other feature selection methods, and there are many things that we've done with a different student. We created a data set by extracting websites from Fish Tank and OpenFish and Alexa for legitimate websites, and the plan is to compare the performance with other feature selection methods on more than data sets, including our own data set. Thank you for your attention. So if you have any questions.
Thank you, Arghir. It was a great presentation. So we have a couple of questions in the chat from Cyril. So the first one is, what is the rationale of using 13 features? And if you did investigate using lower, higher number of features before setting up it to 13?
Again, the 13 features were the process of ending up with what we call the optimal 13 features was, first we identify 18 common features between two data sets, and then we applied variance inflation factor as a feature selection method to identify features that have high multicollinearity, and then we use the threshold of 5 for VIF. So basically, the number of features, more or less, depends on the threshold that you pick for your feature selection method. So in this particular case, we used 5 because one previous study indicated that VIF scores of 5 and above, they indicate critical multicollinearity issues. But we've seen other papers, for example, they may recommend to remove all the features with a VIF score as of 3 and above. Okay. Now, so that was the rationale, basically, why we used 13.
Another question we have in the chat is, were you able to detect dynamic generated domain names related to phishing attacks? I think that in your introduction, you were mentioning the ones related to COVID.
No, so basically, again, in this particular work, we used pre-processed datasets in the sense that we didn't have the original URLs. The datasets consisted already of extracted features, so we didn't have the URLs, and the focus was not on detecting things like dynamically generated URLs.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I guess I will have time for last question. So you presented the time that you, the reduction of time that you need to build the model and the reduction of time for the feature extraction, but you didn't mention about the reduction of time in the detection. I guess that's one of the advantages of doing feature detection is that you have a much faster detection rate, especially when you have thousands and thousands of emails probably received per minute.
Maybe it was a bit misleading. Actually, the time that it's reported, it's the time of the complete application that takes the URL as input. It extracts the features and it predicts if the website is phishing or URL phishing or legitimate. But what we notice is that most of that time is because of the feature selection. So predicting a URL once you have the extracted features,
mm-hmm.
using the machine learning model, it's very fast. But I'll take that as a
mm-hmm.
as a feedback to also report separately, so train, test, and prediction. Right?
Yeah, no, but that's great. I mean, if you had it together, that's all right. Okay, I think that we don't have time for any more questions. So thank you very much, Arghir.